I'll sing and shout it, for he's there. lady just asked me tonight when we come in, she said, are you bad sick? Eric, there's something lowered. What did? But I've just been a little bit under the weather, but I'm just thankful to be here tonight. I'm thankful that I was able to be here tonight, and I'm thankful that I can serve the Lord through the song and in any way I can. I stood in the courtroom, the judge looked my way. It seems like you're guilty, now what do you say? I spoke up, Your Honor, I have no defense, but that's when mercy walked in. Oh, mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand, was God's saving grace. The blood was presented that covered my forgiven when mercy walked in. I stood there and wondered, how could this be, that someone so guilty had just been set free? My chains were broken, I felt born again. The moment that mercy walked in, oh, mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand, was God's saving grace. The blood was presented that covered my sins, forgiven when mercy walked in. The blood was presented that covered my sins, forgiven when mercy walked in.
Amen. What a wonderful Savior we got. Amen. Anybody got a testimony while these are at the altar?
Amen.
Anybody in the house?
Hey, Brother John, something you need to know. Wednesday, part of my message I brought to y'all Wednesday was about the son always does what he sees the father do. Do you remember that? Those of you that's here, y'all noticed a minute ago, John's up there with his hand raised, little Isaac sitting right there.
Amen.
Let me tell you, your children's watching.
Amen.
Amen. Bless your heart. Somebody else. Isaiah chapter number 9, the same verse we was on this morning. We go hit the next main. The Bible says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful. Boy, how wonderful he is.
Amen.
The next name is Counselor.
Oh, let's just pray. Father God, we come to you tonight. We thank you, Lord, and praise you, God, for another opportunity, God, to get to stand and share your word, to get to stand and speak about you, to stand and speak about that name which is above every name, Lord. God, I'm so unworthy to stand in this place tonight. Oh, but God, I thank you for allowing me the opportunity. God, for counting me faithful, Lord. God, tonight I ask you to get me out of your way and make me nothing more than your mouthpiece in this place. Thank you, Jesus, for reaching down and saving a soul in this house this morning. And God, there are those in this house tonight that need a touch from on high. And God, we'll be careful to give you the praise and the honor and the glory for everything that's accomplished here tonight. For it's in your sweet, precious, and holy name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Counselor. Counselor. I looked up the description of what a counselor is, and it talks about, or in the definition of a counselor, he's a person who counsels, an advisor. Another place it said a lawyer, an attorney, a litigator, a supervisor, an advisor on the choices that we make. Amen. Y'all, tonight I'm going to tell you something. Jesus is a counselor. And y'all, I just want to go into a little bit of detail tonight, and I'm going to tell you something, that he is the greatest counselor that has ever been or that ever will be. Jesus Christ is the greatest counselor. That if you need counseling in your life, if you need somebody to talk to, let me tell you something. There's nobody better than Jesus. And I don't know tonight, because I'm going to say this. I didn't even look and see who come to the altar. But if you have a need in your life tonight, and in the altar's the place you need to be. Amen. Counseling with a counselor that is above all others. Amen. Amen. He is the counselor. And there's nobody better to get advice from. Because I'm going to tell you something. The Bible says that our ways are not his ways, and neither are our thoughts his thoughts. His thoughts are so much higher than our thoughts, and his ways so much higher than ours. See, I'm going to tell you something. When we start thinking about our choices that we make in life, we can't see very far out there. We can have a 5-year plan, or we can have a 10-year plan in our life. We can say we're going to set out and we're going to accomplish this or this and this. And y'all, just let me just be honest with you tonight. We really don't know what tomorrow brings. We don't know if we're going to accomplish those 5-year or 10-year plans. We don't know what kind of decisions we need to make. We don't know what kind of choices we need to make in our lives, because we can't see the future. Oh, but we got a Jesus. We got a counselor. We got an advisor that can look out through the hands of time. He knows exactly what tomorrow brings in your life. He knows exactly what tomorrow brings for each one of us. If you're going to have a car wreck tomorrow, let me just tell you something. It's not going to surprise the Lord. He's already there. Amen. He already knows what tomorrow brings. So who better to ask advice from than somebody who already knows what tomorrow brings?
Amen.
Who better to get counsel from than the advisor that sets high and lifted up? I heard one preacher say one time, he sets high and lifted up, but he sure does reach awful low. Amen.
Amen.
Because he reaches down and he saves us. But who tonight better to ask advice from than from the one that can see the future? Who better to ask advice from than one that has your best interest at his heart?
Amen.
Y'all, let me tell you something tonight. So many times in our world today, we will seek advice and we will seek counseling. And don't tell me that I'm not right about this, because I know I am. Because you know why? I'm a human being and I do the exact same thing. Whenever I want advice or I want counsel from somebody, I want to go to somebody that I know is going to agree with.
Come on.
Amen. Come on. Amen. I want to go to somebody and say, ain't that right? And they're going to say, yeah, you're right. Not with Jesus.
No.
We go to Jesus and say, ain't that right? And he's going to say, no, you ain't right.
Amen.
But those people that we have in our lives that always agrees with us, that always counsels us toward, let me just tell you something. They're counseling you because, or you're seeking their counsel because you know that they're going to agree with you. You know that, and let me just say this. They've got an ulterior motive. They don't want to make you mad.
Yeah. Amen.
Jesus don't care if he makes you mad.
Amen.
I'm going to just be honest with you. The more I read and the more I study and the more I learn about my Lord, He has your best interest at His heart.
Amen.
And He wants what's best for your life. So He's not going to sugarcoat it. He's not going to make you think that everything's all right when everything's not all right. Y'all, He is the counselor above all other counselors. Who better to seek advice or counsel from somebody that wants the very best for you?
Amen. Amen.
And He don't care if you like Him back or not. He wants what's best for you. See, when we go to somebody and seek counsel from somebody that's going to be a yes man, that's going to say, yes, 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 you're exactly right, they got an ulterior motive behind them because they want to please you.
Yeah, come on.
They want to please you. They want to say, yes, you're right, because they care what you think. It's not, they don't have your best interest at heart. They've got their own best interest at heart. But Jesus has got your best interest at His heart. In the center of His will is the only place you'll find happiness.
Amen.
Amen.
But how often are we as Christians out of the center of God's will? We're out of God's will because we want to strike our own trail. We want to blaze our own trail and do things our own way and seek nobody's advice, seek especially not Jesus' advice. I'm going to tell you something, and I'm going to confess something to you. But like I've told you before, I'm pretty open. I just tell you exactly how it is. But when I'm caught in a fault, when I've got sin in my life, you know what it does? Very first thing it does is it affects my prayer life. Do you know why? Because I know where I'm at.
Amen. Amen.
And I don't want to talk to Him about where it is I'm at. Amen?
Amen?
That's us as human beings. We don't want to seek counsel. We don't want to seek advice, especially when we already know we're wrong.
Yep.
I had some teenagers that I had the privilege and the honor of getting to mentor and getting to teach on Wednesday nights and getting to talk to. And y'all, it just blowed my mind that they'd come up with some off-the-wall questions for me. They said, Brother John, is it wrong to, and you just fill in the blank. You know what Brother John finally advised them? If you've got to ask me, you already know it's wrong.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you've got to come to me and ask me, you already know it's wrong. But we're just as guilty as those teenagers are. We try to justify everything that we do in our lives, the choices that we make, the choices that we choose, the things we choose not to do, the choices that we make each day, we try to justify them in our lives. When Christ puts somebody in front of us and that Holy Spirit whispers to you and says, speak to them about the Lord, or tell them, speak my name to them, tell them about how Jesus saved. We'll say, well, God, I'm too busy. I got to do this over here. I got to take care of this right here. Or God, I'll do those things later. I'll reach out later. I'll be the missionary that you want me to be later on. When I'm not so busy, when I'm not got so many hours that I got to put in at work, or when I'm not building a house, or when I'm not got my calves coming in, or whatever the case may be, we'll say, well, God, we're gonna put that off. We're gonna obey you, but we're gonna do it later on.
Yeah,
then it affects your prayer life. Yeah, you know amen. Why it does? Because amen. We know we're wrong.
Amen. Right.
But Jesus has your best interest at His heart. And let me tell you something. When He pecks on your heart's door and says, hey, share the gospel with them, it's for your benefit.
That's right. Amen.
It's for your benefit because it's going to build your faith. And you're going to realize and get to see what Jesus can do in somebody else's life. And I'm going to tell you this tonight. If He is dealing with you about sharing the gospel with somebody else, it's because He's already been there.
Amen. Amen.
He's already been there. Man, what a counselor. What a counselor. What advisor would we better rather go to? But let me say this tonight. I and I want you to get this, and that's why I asked Brother David to sing that song, When Mercy Walks In. A lot of the scripture in our minds is withheld, and in a lot of the scripture it seems like it's talking about something and we don't get a good grasp on it. So tonight I'm going to give you a good grasp on what a counselor is. He's a lawyer. He's an attorney. And he's a litigator. That's what Jesus is. That's what the scripture here, when it says his name shall be called Wonderful, his name shall be called Counselor. It's saying he's going to be your attorney. He's going to be your litigator. He's going to be your lawyer. You say, well, Brother John, I didn't know I needed a lawyer. Oh, yes. Amen. Yes, 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 we need a lawyer. Let me tell you something. In 1 John in chapter 2 and verse number 1, and y'all can jot these down. You can turn really fast if you want to. I can't get my pages turned. I've got it marked. Well, I may have marked the wrong one. Anyway, 1 John 2 verse 1, it says this. That... Don't you know you have an advocate with the Father? It says, my little children, these things write unto you that ye sin not. If any man sin, ye have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous.
Amen.
In other words, he's your lawyer. He's your advocate. He's the one that stands there and pleads your case before a holy, just, and an almighty God. He is your lawyer. He's your litigator. And let me just tell you something tonight. There is no one in this world that is more qualified to be your lawyer before a holy and a just and an almighty God than a holy and a just and an almighty lawyer.
Amen.
He knows the law right down. The Bible says in one place that not a jot or a tittle will not be fulfilled, but the entire law will be fulfilled. The Bible says that Jesus came not to destroy the law, but to fulfill the law. And I'm going to tell you something. As Christ lived on this earth, he fulfilled every jot and every tittle that law talked about. And because he did, he's righteous. And because he's righteous and because he's just, he is allowed or able to be our advocate, to be the one that stands in our place and argues our case before a holy and a just God. Oh, man, ain't that good? Ain't that good? You say, Brother John, I didn't realize that I needed a lawyer, that I needed an advocate. In Revelations chapter 12 and verse number 10, and I want y'all to get this, because we're going to nail this home. If you don't get it, I'm going to say this, it ain't going to be my fault, because I'm going to give it to you. Revelations 12 and verse 10, it says, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. If you read in the book of Job, and the Bible says that there's a great big roll call of what happens in heaven, and all the sons of God presented themselves to God, and the Bible says that Satan was there, and God said, have you considered my servant Job? They start this conversation. Immediately, Satan begins to accuse Job. He said, you're just, I'd praise you too if you had given me all that you've given Job. And I'd praise you too if you'd put a hedge of protection around about him the way you did. See, Satan was accusing Job there in the book of Job. And the Bible tells us in the book of Revelation that he is the brethren's accuser that comes before God day and night. That's what's taking place right now. See, we have in our minds confined ourselves into thinking that Satan is this little horn guy with a pitchfork that's living in hell. Let me tell you something, that's not the case. In the book of Job, when God asked Satan, he said, where have you been? He said, I've been going to and fro in the earth and walking up and down in it. Let me tell you this, and if they're appearing before God to accuse the saints, so let me just tell you what he's doing right now. He's taking and he is accusing us before God even right now.
Amen.
He's saying, Gerald Green ain't right with you. Have you seen what Gerald Green's done in his life? Do you remember when Gerald was flipping through and he stopped on that station and stayed too long? That's what Satan's doing. And Satan is right there with God the Father, and he's saying, "Do you see that John Mays? Do you know that thought that he thunked yesterday?" I said, "Thunk." Did y'all get that? Do you know what he was thinking yesterday? Do you know how he was acting the other day? Do you know this and you know that and you know this? He's up there constantly accusing the brethren. Constantly trying to bring reproach upon the brethren. So we need an advocate.
Amen.
We need somebody to step in our ear and say, "Hey, listen, that's one of mine. That's one of mine. I done paid for his sin. I realize that he's sinning, but I done paid for that sin. He's done accepted my free gift of salvation." So, y'all, I'm going to tell you tonight, he is the greatest counselor that has ever been. He's the greatest lawyer that has ever been. Doesn't matter what Satan throws at him about us.
Come on.
Jesus standing there and said, "Done paid for that one too."
Amen.
I paid for that one too. Let me tell you something. When Christ died for us on the cross, he paid for every sin that we'll ever commit.
Amen.
And you know what? He can see the future, so he knew every sin that you would commit, and he died and shed just enough blood to cover every one of them.
Amen.
But Satan is standing right there accusing the brethren. He said, and y'all, it's not only before God that he's accusing the brethren. He's also accusing the brethren before other folks on this earth.
Amen.
Come on.
How many times have you heard somebody say, "Well, if that's a preacher, the woods is full of them"? I've heard that about me. Amen?
Yeah, come on.
If they're a church, I'm not going to church because they're all just a bunch of hypocrites. Amen. Did you see how they acted? Do you see how they conduct themselves? And should we live a holy a life to the glory of God? Absolutely. But y'all, you know what? We're enrobed in a robe of flesh, and we're going to mess up. I'm sorry to tell you, we're going to mess up, and we're going to have somebody that don't think of us like what we need to be thought of, and Satan's going to come along and say, "Did you see what they did?" Constantly accusing the brethren. But I got an advocate with the Father.
Amen.
I got a lawyer that stands in and says, "Hey, I paid for that sin. I paid for what he did." He knows the law backwards and forwards. What better counselor would you have? Let me share with you in the book of Zechariah in chapter 3. I've set up for you and showed you that he's our lawyer. In Zechariah chapter number 3, it says this. And I'm going to read several verses here, but I want you to get what's taking place. I've set up the background for you of what's happening in heaven and how Satan's accusing the brethren. Zechariah chapter 3, it says, "And he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. And the Lord said unto Satan, The Lord rebuke thee, O Satan. Even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire?" Oh, I could nearly shout.
Amen.
And I'm liable to have a shouting spell here in just a minute. But you know what was taking place? The Bible says that Joshua here, the high priest, was standing before this great courtroom there in heaven, said that Satan was standing at his right hand to resist him, to accuse him, to talk about him, to try to drag him down, to try to tell him that he wasn't worthy to be standing where it was that he was standing. But the Bible says that the angel of the Lord was there. And let me tell you who that was. That was my Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. The angel of the Lord was standing there. And the Bible says that he rebuked Satan. And said that, in other words, and y'all forgive me, and those that are you that are trying to raise your kids right and not tell them to say certain things, but let me just put it on Sand Mountain terms for you. Jesus looked at Satan and said, shut up. Before you ever get started, just shut up. Amen?
Amen.
That's what he did to him right there. And he looks at Satan, he said, the Lord rebuke thee. O Satan, even the Lord that has chosen Jerusalem, rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? Now this morning, really quickly, and I talked about how that you're not supposed to go to hell. That is not God's plan for any person. Well, you think about what a brand is. It is something. You can't start a fire with a brand. It's something that is not supposed to be there, but it's laid into the fire. And Jesus, talking to Satan, he says, is this not a brand plucked out of the fire? Is this not something that's supposed to have been there or not supposed to have been there, and I reached down and I got it out? Amen. That's what he's talking about. And even the same with us. Hey, y'all, I'm going to tell you something. Christ plucked us out of the fire. He took us out of the fire, out of the fires of hell when he saved our soul.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. He saved us from the fiery, eternal damnation of hell. That is what he saved us from. And Jesus looked at Satan. He said, you shut your mouth before you ever get started. You don't even start bringing accusation against them because that was a brand that I plucked out of the fire. Amen. That's the one that I've chosen, that I've taken out of the fire. Oh, thanks be to God, this tonight, ain't he a wonderful counselor?
Amen.
Ain't he a great attorney?
Amen.
Amen. He don't even let the prosecution have a case. He don't even let the prosecution begin to bring accusation. He says, you just hush your mouth, I done plucked him out of the fire.
Amen.
Oh, man, that's good.
Amen.
That don't make you want to shout your woods wet. Amen. If it don't light you up, something's wrong with you. And it goes on to say there. There in verse number 3 it says, now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and stood before the angel. Joshua was clothed with filthy garments. The Bible tells us that our righteousness is as filthy rags. Okay? Joshua was standing there before the angel with filthy garments, and he answered and he spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
What a lawyer, what a counselor that it is that we've got that says, looks, and he sees our filthiness. He sees the awfulness that there is about us. But he tells the accuser, he says, you hush your mouth. I've done took him out of the fire. And then he looks at his enemy and he tells the other angels, he says, you go get him some new clothes.
Amen.
Y'all, he clothed us in his righteousness.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He looked at our righteousness and it was like filthy rags before his presence. He said, that's all right. I got some new clothes for you, Charlie.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I got new clothes for you, Gerald.
Yes.
He took, and then the Bible says, he says, take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him, he said, behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee, and I will clothe thee with a change of raiment. And I said, let them set a fair mitre upon his head. So they set a fair mitre upon his head and clothed him with garments. And the angel of the Lord stood by. And the angel of the Lord protested unto Joshua, saying, thus saith the Lord of hosts, if thou wilt walk in my ways, here's the Christian life. He removed from us our iniquities. He placed us and enrobed us in a robe of righteousness. He put a mitre on our head. And y'all, it's sort of like a crown, but not exactly. But it's what the high priest wore. And what it did was it showed our authority. It's what he placed on Joshua's head. And then the Bible says that this lawyer, this advocate that we have with the Father, began to speak to Joshua. And y'all, as we take this, I want you to think of him as speaking to you. If you've been saved tonight, this is for you. He said, "Thus saith the Lord of hosts, if thou wilt walk in my ways, and if thou wilt keep my charge, then thou shalt also judge my house, and shalt also keep my courts, and I will give thee places to walk among these that stand by." Amen.
Amen.
Follow in his what he has for you. Do the commandments. Jesus says in one place, if somebody loves me, they'll keep my commandments.
Amen.
That's what he's telling him. And he said, I'm gonna make you a place to walk in among these that stand by. Well, who was standing by? The angels. Same ones that went and got him some new clothing. Same ones that took away his old and filthy, nasty, dirty clothing. Same ones that put that mitre on his head.
Come on.
Oh, hallelujah. What a lawyer. What a lawyer. What a counselor that we have with our Savior. But a counselor can tell us the letter of the law. He's lived the letter of the law, and he's done exactly what we're supposed, or what he's supposed to do, and we're supposed to seek his advice. But a counselor is also something else. And I found this to be food for thought. Summer camp, what do they call them people that watches the kids? Counselors. Counselor is a supervisor. A supervisor. What better supervisor than Jesus?
Amen. Amen.
You know, the Bible says in one place, if I ascend up into heaven, he's there. If I make my bed in the lowest pits of hell, he is there. And it tells us that his eyes are on the sparrow, not one sparrow falls out of the sky that he doesn't know about. And how much more special are you than they? Amen. That you know the scripture I'm talking about. That's a supervisor, that his eyes are on you all the time. Wow, what a counselor. What a counselor. This morning we talked about how he knows exactly what you're going through. He cares about what you're going through. He's got the legal authority to do something about it, and he's been supervising it the whole time.
Amen. Amen.
Counselor. Counselor. He's wonderful. He's a counselor. And then in the next name is the Mighty God. The Mighty God. We've talked about that before. In the person or in the name of God the Father is El Shaddai. He does not divide away from his Father. He is the Mighty God.
Amen.
He is the Mighty God. He is El Shaddai. And then he goes on and says he's the Everlasting Father. El Elohim. The Everlasting Father. The Everlasting Father. But y'all, tonight, for just a minute, I want you to think about this. In the top part of verse number 6 there, it says that unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. He shall be, in his name shall be Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father. This is a child. This is a child that the Bible's speaking of. This is Jesus, the Bible's speaking of. But it gives new meaning. The Bible says that without him nothing was made that was made. All things were made by him and for him. He is from everlasting to everlasting. When he says, and that we talked about last week, he's Alpha and Omega. He's the beginning and he's the end.
Amen.
He's always been and he always will be. He's the everlasting Father. But Isaiah was prophesying about the coming birth of the Messiah. But the Messiah had always, always been. Amen. The everlasting Father, El Elohim. And the last one, the last name, is the Prince of Peace. The Prince of Peace. Tonight, I want to ask you, and I want you not to answer me, but to answer God. And I want to ask you a question. Have you met the Prince of Peace? Have you met the Prince of Peace? Because I'm going to say this tonight. For a lot of Christians, they go through their entire lives, they never got peace. They're struggling, always, constantly struggling. They're struggling in their families. They're struggling with their church life. They're struggling in their work life. They're struggling with all of these things, and they seem to never have peace. But Jesus is the Prince of Peace.
Amen. Amen.
He's the Prince of Peace. He's the one that can put you to bed at night and let you know that everything's going to be all right. You know, the Scripture tells us, and I love the Scripture, one of my most favorite Scriptures in all the Bible, it says that weeping may endure for the night, but brother, let me tell you something, joy comes in the morning. If you know the Prince of Peace. Y'all, I'm going to tell you something. As we look at this world and at the shape that we've gotten in, Iran is over there threatening all of these things. Russia is on the move and threatening all these things. China is on the move in the South China Sea. We're seeing this world immediately. I'm going to tell you something. Within the next year and a half, we could see this world in a world war. You hear me? And y'all, I'm just going to give you my honest opinion about what's going on and about what's taking place. God's still in control and His hand is still in control. But we don't have exactly who we need up in the up on Capitol Hill making the right decisions. We don't have exactly who we need in the White House making the right decisions. And y'all, this is getting dangerous and this is getting hairy. And we could be in the midst of a world war before you know it. Say, Brother John, that's gloom and doom. I'm telling you, I watch the TV. I know what's going on in this world, and anybody that says everything's okay, there's something wrong with them.
Amen. Amen.
Everybody that says, hey, we're on the right track now, there's something wrong with them. When all of this world is coming, and it could immediately come into chaos. How will you sleep then? If you know the Prince of Peace, regardless of the war, regardless of the struggle, regardless of the things that are taking place, you can lay yourself down at night knowing that, you know what? It's all going to be all right.
Amen.
Because He has got the whole world in His hands.
Amen.
It's all going to be okay because He is the Prince of Peace. I was corrected this past week, or maybe in the week before. Somebody asked me to define peace, and I said it was the absence of war. He said, no, Brother John, it's not the absence of war. It's the ability to get through the war and be okay.
Amen.
That's right. Do you know the Prince of Peace? Do you know Him? Have you got peace in your life? Because I'm going to tell you something tonight. You need to know Him. You need the Prince of Peace in your life. You need Him. I'd hate to know that I had to lay down the night without Him.
Amen.
I'd hate to know that I had to walk outside of my house tomorrow without the Prince of Peace on my side. Wouldn't you?
Amen.
So tonight, as I've asked you that question, do you know Him? Do you know the Prince of Peace? Many of you are sitting here tonight and you're thinking, yeah, I know Him. I know Him. I know Him. How does it show in your life that you know Him? How does it show in your life that you know the Prince of Peace? Have you got anxiety about what's happening, what's taking place in this world? Y'all, this country is so divided right now. It is so divided. And so many people are against so many other people. And y'all, I'm just on Jesus' side. I'm on the
Amen.
Prince of Peace's side.
Amen.
Have you got anxiety about the things that are taking place, the things that are going on? Tonight, ask the Prince of Peace to give you some peace. If you know Him. And if you don't know Him, tonight will be a great time to be introduced
Amen.
To Him.
Amen. Amen.
Because He'll be your counselor. He'll be your attorney. He's already, we talked about it this morning, He's wonderful. But He'll be your counselor. He'll be your attorney. He'll be your supervisor. He'll be your confidant. He'll be the one that you can seek advice from. He'll be all of those things just for you. Because He loves you and He cares about you.
Amen. Amen.
He'll be the mighty God in your life. He'll be the everlasting Father in your life. And He'll be the Prince of Peace in your life. But you've got to let Him. There's times, sometimes, y'all, when I'd like to go to people and just drag them to the altar. I would. I'll tell y'all this, and I've told this before. I don't know if I've told it from the pulpit, so that's why I'm standing down here. But there was one Sunday, we was over in the old church, and there's a young man, he was sitting, he was lost, and he was undone without God. And he was sitting on the very front row. There wasn't nowhere else in the church house for him to see it. And he'd come in late, and he was sitting right there on the very front row. And I knew he was lost. I'd talked to him, I'd witnessed to him, I'd invited him to know Jesus. He had sat and he had heard me preach time and time again. And he had felt the Spirit move all over the house. I seen that boy cry and I seen him hang on to the pew that was in front of him. And this Sunday, he was standing up and during the altar call, just standing there. And I said, God, I got down in the altar right there in front of him. I said, God, he ain't even got a pew to hang on to this morning. Why don't you just kick him right down here beside of me so that way I can introduce him to you.
Amen.
Y'all, I wanted to turn around and y'all, we had that front pew. We had added more pews because we didn't have no... I started turning around and just reached back there and just grabbed it. But you know what? It wouldn't done no good.
Amen.
It wouldn't done a lick of good. Because I can't save nobody. But I sure can introduce you to the one that can.
Amen.
I can introduce you to the Prince of Peace. I can. And this morning, I got to introduce one to somebody that was wonderful. I got to introduce A-Rod to a wonderful Savior. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
To think He reached down from on high and saved a little lost soul in our house, and we got a new sister today.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
But I don't think He's done yet.
Amen.
I don't think He's done yet. I think He wants to save somebody else. He wants to draw them and pluck them as a brand out of the fire. He wants to put a robe of righteousness upon you. He done seen all you've done. He done knows all about that. And He shed enough blood to forgive you of your sins.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Wonderful Counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Do you know Him? Brother Eric, play us a song. Y'all stand to your feet.
You say, Brother John, this is Sunday night. You get saved just as good on a Sunday night as you can on a Sunday morning.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come near. voices that we hear off the Bible service. You know, tonight we've heard them giggling. We've heard them speaking to each other. I'm so thankful that they're in this house.
Amen.
And they're hearing God's
Amen.
Word. But I want to praise Him tonight for what He's done today.
Amen. Amen. Somebody else.
John, I want to say that I love him. I've told my Sunday school class over and over that in order to get a fire, you've got to start with a flame.
Amen.
And I built a brush pile yesterday, and I, you know, it started off small, but by the end of the day, it was engulfed. It was hot. It was
Amen.
The coals was hot. You know?
Amen.
And I thank Him that we have that same ability that we can go out in our community tomorrow,
Amen.
Tonight. And we can start that flame, and by the end of the week, it can be so hot.
Amen.
Those 40,000 people in our county that don't go to church,
Amen.
That will be here next Sunday.
Amen.
Amen.
I believe that.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Somebody else.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.